So I will give you a brief overview in only half an hour, which is very short, to introduce ultrasound imaging and the basic physics behind it. If you look at the 3 years curriculum, we are here in year one and our main focus is only the basics of wave propagation and ultrasound, the ultrasound imaging principle, and I will talk a little bit about resolution, penetration, depth, so basic features of ultrasound imaging. The topics covered are in this list here. I will have 4 points. The application and examples will not be in the block at the end, but a little bit in between everywhere. And so after this, you should know roughly how B-mode imaging in ultrasound works. In the next years, we will have more flow and contrast media, which is especially the contrast media for this conference and this audience, maybe the most important topic because this is used for molecular imaging. And the advanced beamforming techniques and the fast 3D techniques that are new now, especially in the clinical scanners, that will come in the last year. And maybe we will see this in small animal scanners one day, but it's not present there at the moment. So start with what is ultrasound. Maybe I'm telling you a lot of things you already know, but I go through all of that. It's a mechanical wave, just like sound, but it's only in its frequency above 20 kilohertz, so you cannot hear it. In medical ultrasound, we typically are much higher. We are even at 1 megahertz, so 1 million oscillations. And the mechanical waves in fluids cannot couple any shear stresses. So what they do is they are longitudinal waves. And in this little video, you can see what they do. The particles in the medium, they propagate only back and forth. There's a red dot here. You can follow it. And still, it looks like the points are moving in one direction if there's overpressure and in the other if there's underpressure. So the energy is transported by the wave, but the particles stay in place. And it's important to understand that this means for a certain point that it sees phases of overpressure and underpressure from the normal pressure in the fluid. In tissues, this is very similar because tissues are very similar to fluids. Most soft tissues, bone is different. We will look at the properties later. So what are the typical, I don't go too much in the physics, but what are the typical ways to describe a wave? You have two things. You describe the particle velocity, which is one measure of the wave, and the other one is the pressure, as I already said. The product of both tells you something about the intensity of the ultrasound wave. And the material is characterized by two other material constants. It's the mass density, so how much mass do you have to move in the tissue, and the compressibility, so how is the tissue, the little particles, coupled to each other. A large compressibility means it can be compressed easily, like air. There's one important figure. If you have an ultrasound scanner, you rarely see something like what pressure is this scanner applying. What you can find is a warning number on the screen sometimes if it is high enough. That's called the mechanical index. The mechanical index gives you a hint if there is a danger of the underpressure phase of the wave of tearing the tissue apart, so causing cavitation. We accept that there is a little bit of cavitation in some applications if you go very high with your intensity, and the number that characterizes this is the maximum negative pressure in megapascal divided by the square root of the frequency in megahertz. Somebody found out that this is a good number to characterize the mechanical stress that is posed on the tissue. And so sometimes you find that on the scanners, it's limited at 1.9, at around 1.0, you have a certain risk of cavitation. And if it is below 0.5, 0.4, the scanner doesn't have to display it. So we already talked about the frequency, which is in the megahertz range for ultrasound imagers. We have another number, that's the speed of sound, so that's the wave speed propagation, the speed of wave propagation. And we have the wavelength, which is very important because the wavelength gives you some idea of the resolution of the ultrasound scanners. So it's just a principal number where you can get a feeling of what resolutions can be achieved. So let's look at typical numbers. Wavelength is sound speed divided by frequency. And if you take the normal average sound speed you have in most soft tissues or water, we sometimes calculate with exact numbers, but a rough number is 1,500 meters per second. If you divide this by 1.5 megahertz, then you get 1 millimeter wavelength. So that's this pair here. And if you go on, you see that's the typical range about of clinical scanners from 1.5 megahertz to 15 megahertz. So you have wavelengths in the range of 1 to 0.1 millimeters. And that gives an idea of the resolution the method can achieve if it is done correctly. Preclinical scanners, if you have small animal scanners, there are several, or there are some on the market. The preclinical scanners typically start at about 15 megahertz and go up, not to 150. I just used this. Typically, they enter up at about 50, 70 megahertz with their frequencies. But you see then the resolution can be much higher, and you can also image like mice and rats in very good resolution. We assume in ultrasound imaging that the speed of sound in tissues is constant. This is one of the assumptions that is not really true, and I will talk about that later. if you look at the different speed of sounds of fat, liver, muscle, and soft tissue, average here is 1540 meters per second. This is all very similar, so it's about 10% difference between the different numbers. If you have something like air, this is completely different, and completely different is also bone. They have different speed of sounds, and there's another number here that is the acoustical impedance. Speed of sound is easy to understand, but acoustical impedance, if you calculate this, it's also calculated by the mass density times the speed of sound. That's the number that tells you if there's a difference in the acoustical impedance, that is telling you how strong a reflection will be. So a change in acoustical impedance causes reflection or scattering. And so there's little difference in this acoustical impedance for most soft tissues, but there's a big jump for bone and also a very big one for air. That means when you use an ultrasound scanner, if there's somewhere air or there's somewhere bone, you will have a very strong reflection, and that will have also problems to transport the sound deeper into the tissue. It will be stopped at the air or the bone level. So we have what everybody knows from the physics class. We have reflection and refraction at interfaces, and in optics it's determined by the refractive index. In acoustics it's determined by this acoustical impedance difference, and what we have is we have a reflected wave under the same angle as the incoming wave, and we have a refracted transmitted wave on the other side. These effects typically are this change in speed of sound typically is not taken into account when we do ultrasound imaging. Okay, so we have two effects which cause the echoes that we record in ultrasound imaging. We have the ultrasound transducer. It sends a high frequency pulse to the tissue. And there are two effects. One is that you have a real tissue border, so a jump from one impedance to another. That gives you a strong reflection. But most of the image contents you see in an ultrasound image is caused by little changes in the impedance, which have a scale much smaller than the wavelength. And we call this scattering, and so you get acoustic scattering, and this is filling up most of your image. So how are images done using ultrasound waves? The principle is very simple, what most scanners use nowadays. That's the pulse echo principle. So you have a transducer on one side here, and you send in a high frequency pulse. This travels down into the tissue, and it will see different material impedances here over depth, and this will cause reflections and scattering, and we record this, and the echo looks like this, a high frequency echo. We are not interested in the oscillation, we are only interested in the echo strength, so we use some calculations to just detect the envelope, and this envelope is then translated to brightness on your screen, and you get one line of your ultrasound image. For the whole principle to work, you have to make sure that the sound also travels nearly on one line into the tissue, and I will talk about how to do this in the next slide. What you also do is the tissue has attenuation, and you amplify over time to get this decaying amplitude out of the image, and you do this typically by something called the time gain compensation, the TGC. the first generation of small animal imaging systems, the way how an image was built, it, a little bit like the clinical scanners in the 80s or before, was done, here's the Vevo system, it was done by mechanical scanning. So you had a little single element transducer and it was wobbled mechanically. And so you got different line positions and you made up an image. And you see the resolution, this is a mouse embryo and there's a scale of ultrasound imaging can be very high if you don't want to have too much penetration depth. But how does the way work? How do we keep the sound on one line? And the trick behind this in modern scanners, where you don't have a mechanical transducer, which is just focused on one line, we use typically electronic beamforming, which is a way to focus along a line with just using electronics and a large number of little transducer elements. So the transducer is made up, the normal ultrasound transducer you see is made up of a large number of elements. These are typically 64 to 256 for normal linear arrays. It can be up to 10,000 for 2D arrays in clinical scanners for cardiac applications, for example. And we use electronic focusing for transmit and receive. That works by little delay lines. So if you send a pulse in that you want to send, this is distributed on different channels and they are all delayed differently. So what you get is this pulses with time delays, which leads to the ones on the borders sent first. And if you assume the elements are very little and produce a sound wave like a circle, like a spherical wave, then we get an overlay of all these spherical waves, and you see there builds up a wave front, which is a circle, which has a center, which is the focus. That's the point where all these waves will travel to at the same time they will arrive here in the focus. And if I start a simulation, you see in the back the wave forming. Here it is still not very focused. Now in the focus, it's running on a line. And then it defocuses again. So around the focus, you are able to put the sound on a line. That's the trick how to say we are just recording from that line. And before and behind the focus, you are losing the resolution and the focusing on this line. The good thing is in receive, you can focus all the time. In the end, line by line, you make up your image with a linear transducer. What's also possible is beam steering. That means you don't have to do a straight line. You can also use an angle. That leads to different scan geometries and array types. For small animal imaging, you very often find the linear arrays. In clinical scanners, you also find convex arrays, which are easier to access the abdomen. And you have phased arrays for mostly for cardiac applications, where you just change the angle of the beam that you send into the tissue. And sometimes in some small animal scanners, you find single element transducers, but they use still an array, which is called an annular array that can focus in depth, but just on a line and still has to be wobbled mechanically. Once you send your sound pulse, it is focused on a certain distance, on a certain focal spot. You cannot change this anymore. So if you want to have a focused image over all depths, you have to send several times. That's what most ultrasound scanners do. So they focus in different depths and get different quality of focus, but then they switch from one focal zone to the other when they produce the resulting image. So they fade out the first image, which is not well focused anymore, and fade in the next image. In receive, it's different because in receive, you could store all the echoes and you could do the focusing afterwards. What the ultrasound scanners do is they change the delays and they change the aperture used on the transducer while they are recording the echoes. And this leads to a continuous focusing over depth. And so you have the ability to have in receive a focus, which is always focused on where the sound comes from. Because you know it's an echo, it has to travel a certain time and come back. You know exactly where it should come from. You can focus there in receive and you can let that focus travel with the sound wave. So in receive, we have something called dynamic focusing. And all these electronic tricks were not possible in the scanners of, let's say, the beginning 80s or earlier. And that's what changed ultrasound, all the electronics and the computing power, which make so much better images nowadays, which are much better focused than they were in the past. Just a practical hint, the transmit foci you can see on the screen of most scanners. Here you see it for normal clinical scanners. This has three focal zones that have been placed in this area because the clinician was interested in this part. And this is a scan of the Vevo system, which has a fixed focus here at 6 millimeters of a tumor. Sorry. We have now talked about the focus, and I only showed you 2D slides of ultrasound images, but there's a third dimension, and that's the perpendicular direction of the array. So here's the scan direction, and perpendicular, most systems focus just using a sort of acoustic lens. That means the third dimension has a focus in a fixed distance. That's often forgotten. That makes your slice thickness of the image in one part of the image very small and in other parts rather big. So you can have partial volume effects and all the trouble that the varying slice thickness can bring. There are some 2D arrays with a low number of array elements which can focus in elevation direction, also with dynamic focusing. And we also have nowadays 2D arrays. A 1D array I showed you can move the beam in one direction and has a low number of elements. All these elements are connected by single coaxial cable, so that means in a normal scanner up in this cable set here, you have something like hundreds of little coaxial cables going to the main system. And they do line-for-line imaging, so they image one line after the other. 3D systems, they use something like thousands of elements. So if it is only 64 by 64, you already have 4,096 elements. The problem is if you want to acquire quickly a 3D volume and you do line-by-line scanning, the sound is too slow. You cannot change the speed of sound. It has to travel and come back. If you do that for thousands of lines, one after the other, you cannot do, for example, real-time cardiac imaging. So very often, multi-line scanning is needed, or we do something I won't explain in this talk, which is plane wave imaging. You just send a plane wave. You don't focus on transmit. You only focus on receive. That's what these systems do. Here you see an example from Siemens, another one from Philips. All major companies have 2D arrays, especially for cardiac imaging. And what you see is, especially in this image, you have to use a lot of integrated electronics. Philips has more than 9,000 channels with individual beam forming on each channel, which is already integrated into the scan head. So what is the basic resolution of ultrasound? Here you see what a scanner in the 80s perhaps would have done, a fixed focus at 60 millimeters. And in the focal point, a point is really imaged as a point. If you are before the focus and you have a little dot that should appear in the image, instead you get a very wide, unfocused shape here. Nowadays, with dynamic focusing, the scanner can get a uniform focusing over depth. Roughly the axial direction, which is the scan direction of the sound traveling, is determined by the pulse length that you can create. Typically, good scanners can create a pulse which is just one oscillation of the, for example, 5 megahertz frequency. So typically, it is as long, roughly, as the wavelength, the axial resolution. The lateral and elevational resolution depend on the focusing on the aperture. That's much more difficult. That depends on how you create your beam forming and your sound field. Roughly, they scale with wavelength also, but they are always not as good as the axial resolution. So typically, that you see here, they are always a little bit less focused in the lateral direction than in the axial direction. That's typical for ultrasound images. So it means, in general, higher frequency is better resolution, and lateral elevational resolution is not as good as the axial one. That's a very technical slide, and I will go quickly over it. Basically, this tells us if you want to receive echoes from the tissue, and the tissue is directly placed in front of the transducer, let's say at 3.5 megahertz, the typical range of your ultrasound image is from 0 dB to minus 50 or minus 60 dB. That means the strongest echo and the lowest echo are a factor 1,000 apart from each other. When you go into the tissue, this is attenuated, and it's attenuated in a way that it's linear with frequency. We calculate roughly with an attenuation coefficient of 0.6 dB per megahertz centimeter. By this, you can easily calculate, for example, 5 centimeter depth means 5 centimeter going there and coming back is 10 centimeter traveling distance. At 10 megahertz, make 60 dB attenuation. That means only a thousandth of the pressure comes back from this depth. So we have a very strong attenuation, frequency dependent. And this means that for a certain frequency, our dynamic range goes down and down. Of course, we can use an amplifier to get it up again, but somewhere comes the electronic noise floor of the system. So it's a question of how good is your system, how much electronic noise is in the amplifiers. And suddenly your image disappears at a certain depth in the noise. You will see this in a scanner if you scan very deep, and it shows you this on the screen. You will see the electronic noise coming in, and this limits our penetration depth. And when you go up in frequency, your maximum penetration depth goes down. And that's the reason why ultrasound resolution cannot just by going up with the frequency, you can get nice resolution of 10 microns, but you can only penetrate something like 2 centimeters. So it's always a trade-off between penetration depth and resolution. Yeah, some artifacts to look at. I'd make this very short. A typical artifact is, I said, ultrasound imaging assumes straight propagation paths and a constant sound speed. It ignores multiple reflections, different sound speeds, and refraction of wave. That means if something like this happens, the ultrasound system doesn't know that. It always assumes the sound travels on a straight line and it puts it in the image on the straight line. If you see a wave running here, then you see the main wave running here, and here's a little echo running behind it, also causing reflections. And if you look carefully in the beginning, you see where it comes from. It's an echo where the main wave goes to this impedance mismatch, travels back to the transducer, and is reflected at the transducer. And this is traveling behind the main wave we want to have. And this means you get a ghost image by a multiple reflection between a strong reflector and the transducer. And you can see this in typical situations. Here's a liver image with a tumor down here. And you see something like tissue in the back, and you see another tumor here, which is not real, because what you see here is a multiple reflection of the sound going against this very strong reflector at the back of the liver, going in the back of this tumor and imaging it from behind. And the ultrasound system doesn't know that and puts the image down here. That's a typical artifact you have to take care of. That's a typical reflection between a strong reflector and the transducer. It has a characteristic pattern of increasing angles that you see on the right side. Another very important part of artifacts is that you see everywhere in the ultrasound images this little white-black dot pattern, which is called speckle. And I always warn, don't interpret it too much, because it's an interference artifact. It is caused by the little scatterers that you cannot resolve. So there may be hundreds or thousands or millions. They all send back their ultrasound wave, and because these add up, sometimes it adds up destructively and you get a dark spot. Sometimes it adds up constructively and you get a bright spot, but it's random. So this random pattern doesn't tell you much about the tissue structure. It just tells you something about the resolution cell of your ultrasound system. That means here the resolution cell is large, so if you move the scan line to the side, a very long time the resolution cell sees the same scatterers and the effect stays the same, so the bright spot is larger. In the focus, you move only a little bit and it sees different scatterers and it's again dark or bright, so it changes quicker. So what you see as the pattern in the back of a homogeneous phantom, it's an illusion to say the tissue here would be different from the tissue here. It's just an imaging artifact. If you get an ultrasound image without speckle, you can do this by doing an ultrasound image from many directions and overlaying this, then the random addition averages out. Then, for example, an image from the breast would look like this. So it's amazing to see that ultrasound can have no speckle, but that's you have to put some effort into that, and it's not used in all sorts of clinical scanners. That's an artifact I only go very shortly over. That's interesting if you buy an ultrasound system and you buy an array to know what is the spacing of the array. Sometimes you can calculate this very easy. You look how wide is the array and how many channels does the system have, then you can easily calculate what the distance is. And if the spacing is too low, you get something like grating lobes, which means in the end that if you want to take this line of the image, at the same time you're taking lines under a certain angle. And if you have a good array, you want to have something like, it's a very good array, you want to have something like lambda half spacing. But especially in small animal scanners, it's very difficult to achieve that, because if you look already at this scanner, you have to cut something like 8 micron channels between the elements with a laser at a certain depth. So it's quite some challenge to produce small animal systems. So rounding up my talk, you see, I was a little bit, it was difficult to explain everything about a rather complicated imaging method in that short time. I hope I covered the main topics that you know what ultrasound is, of course, and the points that should be covered today. Just to mention again, the imaging, the Meet the Expert session at 15:15 in this room. And just to end up, what I also in my research do is microbubble imaging. That's an example. And I'm only bringing this up because these microbubbles here, they are, they are something like 1 to 10 microns. And now you can ask me, why can I see them when the resolution is 0.1 millimeter? And the answer to that you will get in the next year. I give you the answer now. We can detect them, but we cannot resolve them. If you have two of them very close together, you cannot tell there are two. But if there's a single one, it makes enough echo to detect it in the image. So it's a difference between detection and resolution. And this will be continued next year in the microbubble and contrast media talk. Thank you very much.